Welcome to lecture 8, and we were talking about consecutive reactions, and we had already started discussing it. In fact, we had done quite a bit of that. So if you look at your notes, you will see that we were doing this. So A going to B, B going to C, we are still using species names like A, B and C. So we are not specific about particular species. And we are keeping these reactions relatively simple, because we are not writing, let's say, x plus y giving you p plus q. So we are not writing two species on the left hand side, it's always one species on the left hand side, A going to B and then B going to C. So we did this sort of a set, we called it consecutive reactions, and we wrote expressions for the rates dadt, dbdt and dcdt. And we immediately saw that it was very easy to get concentration of A as function of time. A is A naught e to the power minus k 1 t. The initial condition is that we are starting only with A. So we have concentration A naught of A. There is no B and C to start with. There was only A to start with. So we have dA dt, dB dt, dC dt. And once you get A, it's possible to actually integrate the equations for B and C. And I asked you to do this yourself. You can use an integrating factor to integrate these equations, if you remember what this is. And you should be able to do it yourself. In fact, last semester you had a maths course, maybe it was discussed there also, I don't know. Now B is given by this expression and C is given by this other one. And I asked you to verify, that is, do this at home and verify these expressions. That's where we were, and also we looked at the variations of A, B and C for various cases of K1 and K2. So in fact, not many, we just looked at two different cases. So the first one was something like this. So A, B and C, now in this case K2 is 2 times K1. So you see that A is dropping down exponentially at a fast rate, and B is growing a little bit, but then it's getting consumed. The concentration of B is small compared to concentration of A, but towards the end A and B concentrations are similar, and concentration of C of course has to build with time. So we had seen this, this is for K2 equal to 2 times K1. This I directly took from a book, I also mentioned the book by Nicholas in the last lecture. So I took it from his book, and then we looked at another set of curves, that was when K2 is 200 times K1. So everything else is the same, but now K2 is much larger than K1, and you see that A is slightly sloping down, but very slightly, and concentrations of both B and C have been multiplied by 50. So these are both small. Now we saw two or three main things. Let's say first observation of course is that B and C concentrations are small, but the second observation is that the concentration of B reaches some kind of a steady state. At least it appears to be plateau off. It's almost becoming stable. And we also saw that the concentration of C increases linearly with time. So that means dC dt is becoming a constant. And we didn't have enough time to discuss this, but I also told you that you can in fact go to a software, like a plotting software or Excel, and try to put these functions. You know, we got B equal to some expression, C equal to some expression. And you can utilize this and then just put in some values of K1 and K2 and see how these variations take place. So that's what I told you. I don't know whether you got around to doing this, but I got something that I wanted to show you. I did exactly what I told you in the last class. Okay, so again, concentrations on the y-axis and the x-axis is time. The one which is sloping down slightly is A naught, is A. A is A naught e to the power minus k 1 t. So that is the concentration of A which you see here. Then you have concentration of B which is plotted here, and you also have concentration of C. Just for your reference, I wrote the expressions for all three, concentration of A, B and C as functions of time. So you got all that. Now what I did was, in order to plot, I needed some values. So I used A naught equal to 1 and I used K1 equal to 0.05 and K2 equal to 200. K1 equal to 0.05, K2 equal to 200. So there is a large ratio, and I have used a factor of 1000 for both B and C. Why not 50? Well, that is there in the book, but I am not bound by that. Just use some factor which makes it visible. And the book, in fact, Nicholas's book, it just mentioned K2 by K1 equal to 200, but it did not say how much the value of K1 was. You have to have a value of K1 and only then multiply it by 200 to get the value of K2. So I have K1 equal to 0.05, K2 equal to 200, and I have used a factor of 1000 to plot this. So you can see that the trends are very similar compared to what we had seen on that day. In fact, we have seen today also. So this is a linear increase in C, A sloping down very slightly, and you can also see that B is tending to be plateau off, tending to level off. K1 I used as 0.05 and K2 is 200. K2 is 200, this is the value of K2 is 200, the value of K1 is 0.05. Okay. So the ratio is actually large. And for plotting B and C, I have used, as I mentioned here, I used a factor of 1000. And just to understand this better, because in the last class you were asking some questions regarding the variation of B, I also plotted the individual terms in the B expression. Okay, let's see whether we can bring it into focus now. Yeah, so this is better. You may not be able to read the numbers on the axis, but I think it's okay. Let's just look at the trends and what curves I have plotted. So you see this line on the top, this one here, which goes almost horizontally, that is k1 divided by k2 minus k1 into a0 into e to the power minus k1t. So this is one of the terms. This is the first term in the B expression. We have this expression for B. So this is the first term in the B expression. And this is the second term in the B expression. What is the B expression? You have seen that few minutes back. So B expression has two terms, isn't it? The expression for B has, of course, two terms, and the second term is the one which is plotted here. So what you have to do if you want to get B is to take this term and subtract this term from the first one, all right? And if you do that, you can see visually that you should be getting this solid line, and the solid line is actually B, okay? So that is how these two variations are taking place. So here I have these numbers written also, K1 equal to 0.05, K2 equal to 200, and A0 is equal to 1. I have used a factor of 1000 for all these terms, so that they show up, these curves show up on this plot and you can easily read them. Okay. Now apart from that, let's see, we were talking about the steady state approximation, and we almost ran out of time last time. So since we have this sort of a situation, and we also know that under certain situations, K2 much greater than K1, B is tending to level off. So that is becoming like a steady state. So if that happens, then we can set dB dt equal to 0. And if we set dB dt equal to 0 from here, so we write dB dt So at steady state, this whole thing is actually 0. So that means your B steady state is k1 by k2 times A. Now this has an advantage. A is going to B and B is going to C. In lot of combustion systems, B is in small quantity. The concentration of B is small. So B is a reactive intermediate. B, sometimes you have reactions where B is getting formed slowly and it is getting consumed rapidly. So the concentration of B is small. And if the concentration of B is small, then it is hard to measure that. But from the nature of the reactions, if you know that the first reaction is slow and the second reaction is fast, you expect that the concentration of B to be small, not exactly measurable easily all the time. So you say that, all right, I will not measure B, but I will use the steady state approximation for B, and then you just calculate B steady state as k1 by k2 times A. A is in larger concentration. We have seen that in all these plots. So it should be possible to get A, and I suppose you have some exposure, some knowledge about k1 and k2. So you get k1 and k2, you know what the reactions are, you know k1 and k2. So you get B steady state. Now, we will do one small exercise very quickly. I think we may not be entirely comfortable looking at just the plots and thinking that it might reach steady state in some cases. We saw in the last class that it levels off, but do the equations tell us that it should level off? Do we know that? So to check that out, what we can do is we can write the expression for B, which is now let's talk about large time and k2 by k1 also being a large number. So if that happens, I think it's okay if we approximate this as is this all right? So what have I done? K2 is much greater than K1. So for example, in the plot that I made, K1 is 0.05 and K2 is 200. So K2 is much larger. So we expect that in large times, you know, looking at large time, we expect this to be almost negligible compared to this one. Time is large, but k1 is small, k2 is large. So this term, the second term, will be small compared to the first term. So in that case, we should be able to write this. I have also used k2 by k1 much greater than 1 in writing this part. So this is k1 by k2 times A. Why? Because this is A. So we've done two things. One is that we first assumed in this part, we just assumed that there is a steady state. Okay. Accordingly, without looking at the expression for B, we could say that B steady state should be this much. Then I went back and I said, okay, this is from the plots. From the plots, we know that if k2 by k1 is much greater than 1, then we can expect this. But is it really true? Can we look at the equations and say whether that will happen or not? So even the equation tells you in the limit of large time and large ratio of k2 by k1 that B should be equal to k1 by k2 into A, which is the same as this, right? So these two are same. So we expect steady state even if we analyze the equations properly. And what is the steady state value then? Steady state value of B is k1 by k2 times A. What about dc/dt? dc/dt was k2 times B from the second reaction, B going to C. So, dc/dt at steady state must be k2 times B at steady state. So, this tells you that dc/dt should become a constant, because this is becoming a constant after some time. So, dc/dt is a constant, and that is exactly what we have seen in the plot. Now, to again better understand this, we know this, of course. This is from the set of equations. So, when there is steady state, then this goes to 0. That means k1a becomes equal to k2b. Now, we have to understand this, that the concentration of B has to rise to some level so that k2b is able to balance k1a. Okay, so, one of the questions last time was that why does not B go to 0? Actually, what is happening is B is building up. The concentration of B is building up initially, because initially the second reaction of B going to C is very small. Why? Because the rate of that is k2 times B, and there is not much B, even though k2 is large. So, that reaction is very small. In that meantime, before the second reaction picks up, the first reaction is producing enough B to establish some kind of concentration of B. After that, this balance happens, and once that balance happens, the excess amount of B which is produced by the first reaction is quickly consumed by the second reaction. So, it reaches some kind of a balance, okay, it does not go to 0. That is what we were discussing last time. Now, I will definitely encourage you to plot like the way I have plotted, and I have used a software called Graph, which is in fact freely available on the internet, but you can use Excel or Sigma plot or whatever else you can lay your hands on. Now, let us go back to something which is more concrete, because we wanted to in fact also discuss a realistic equation. So, a realistic thing, we just started discussing, again ran out of time in the last class. So, N2 plus O giving you NO plus N, and N plus O2 giving you NO plus O, these two sets of reactions, and these reactions actually happen. It is no longer A, B, C kind of business, where we were avoiding discussion of complicated stuff, right. So, let us now get more real with this. So,
what is the final product C?
Yeah, so we'll come to that. Actually, NO can be thought of as a product, and N can be thought of as an intermediate. Okay, so, but it is not, I mean, this is happening in the context of, let us say, a full combustion reaction where nitrogen is also present. Okay, so, there is no single product as such, but in the context of these two, you can think of NO to be the product, like that C, and N to be an intermediate, like that B. Okay. Now, let us just change the notation slightly. This is K1F and this is K2F. Yeah.
In between reactions are A, B, C, when the B is at the steady state, finally the steady state what you just proved, then we see that creation of the consumption of A is exactly equal to creation of C. dA dt is equal to dc dt at the steady state.
dA dt equal to
become constant, whatever A is being consumed, it is just equal to C being produced.
Okay, let us see this. You are saying dA dt becomes equal to dc dt.
Yes.
Okay, dc dt is k2 times B, and dA dt is k1 times A, and k1a and k2b are similar. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that happens.
What
that happens.
A is being consumed, exactly the same quantity of C.
Yeah, so B is not changing much. That is what is happening. Correct. But of course, you see that dA dt on the curve is actually very gentle and dC dt is much steeper, right? And A is getting consumed and C is getting produced, correct. Okay. So, we are trying to make it more realistic now, looking at a situation where there are actual reactions. So, do these things happen? These two reactions actually happen, right? And we also have some information on these two reaction rate coefficients. So, this is a reaction rate constant and this is also another reaction rate constant. And let us also consider this set without their reverse reactions. So, when we are talking about reactions, reactions have a forward rate, they also have a backward rate, but let us say for the sake of simplicity we consider only the forward reaction rates. So, that means we are considering that stage of the whole system where the backward reactions have not become strong enough, okay. Now, I said that I have some information on K1F and that K1F, I am just writing expressions, you should think about what units they have, okay. So, that part should also be thought of. So, we have these two, this is K1F and K2F. So, if you look at these two expressions, there is a difference of course, they have by coincidence they have 1.8 as a factor, but this is one, the first one has 1.8 into 10 to the power 11, the second one has 10 to the power 7. The first one does not have linear dependence on temperature anywhere, the second one has a linear dependence on temperature, okay. And most remarkably, the numbers on the top within the exponential term, they are very different, okay. So, this is 38,370 and this other one is 4,680. So, if you look at these, what do you think? Which one at a given temperature is likely to be slower? And we have to think about rates, is not it? You already have a clue that we are talking about reactions which are similar to that A going to B and B going to C. And so, in the A going to B, B going to C consecutive reaction context, we are talking about slow reactions as well as fast reactions. So, which one here is slower and which one here is faster? K1 is slower. K1 will be slower, so that is correct, but why? Yeah, so the in the exponential term you have minus 38370 divided by temperature. Now, what is this 38370 physically, what is it? So, it is, it activation energy or activation proportional to activation energy? This proportional. So, this is it is the exponential term is supposed to be exponential minus E over R bar T. Okay, that is what we write. Let us use a different color here to just point this out. So, this is exponential minus E over R bar T, that is the energy factor, we call it an energy factor. And what you have here is just E by R bar, E by R bar must be 38,370. E by R bar has a name, it is called an activation temperature. Called an activation temperature. So, that activation temperature for the first reaction is 38,370, for the second reaction it is 4,680. So, such a big value of the activation temperature will make sure that the first reaction is in fact much slower, the second reaction is going to be faster. If you are not convinced, choose a temperature and at that temperature calculate the just the energy factors of both the reaction rate constants, okay. You will expect to get a much smaller number for the 38,370 thing. So, that means reaction rate constant information which has come from chemists maybe that tells us that the first reaction is much slower. Now, even otherwise, it's in fact, if you think about it, it's possible to guess that the first reaction will be slower because this is N2 plus O and the N2 has a strong triple bond, which doesn't lend itself easily to break down. So, it doesn't break easily. So, the first reaction is slow, the second reaction is fast. So, we are talking about a similar situation as we had in the consecutive reaction pair, A going to B, B going to C, first reaction slow, second reaction fast. So, what we will try to do is, we will write different rates. So, for example, we will write ddt of NO. So, that is the production rate, that is like dc dt, because NO is kind of like the product of this. And dn dt, ddt of N, ddt of concentration of N, it is like your db dt. So, N, concentration of N is like the concentration of an intermediate. So, it is this reactive intermediate which will help in producing that NO. So, we will write these two expressions and then we also, using these expressions and invoking the steady state approximation and doing a little extra also, which I will tell you about in a few minutes, we will try to construct an overall rate expression for ddt of NO. So, let us see how to do this. First, let us write dNO dt. Okay, maybe it is good to have this here. Yeah, I think it is good to have these reactions here. So, what is dNO dt? Let us do it this way. We are again considering only the forward reactions, mind you. We are not going into the complication of the backward reactions also. So, these are reactions which go only in the forward direction. Now, can you prompt me as to what dNO dt should be? Okay. There will be another term? Correct. So, we've already learned how to write this sort of thing. We had actually done it for some other system. It's H and OH or whatever, some set of reactions I took. Okay, so this is dNO dt and let's write dN dt. So, this term is the contribution of the first equation. So, there will be a minus. So, this is K2F into concentration of N into concentration of O2. So, we can see from here that we expect some kind of a steady state because the first reaction is slow, the second reaction is fast. Who tells us that the first reaction is slow, second reaction is fast? Based on the K1F and K2F expressions, which we just now discussed. So, we have, if we set dN dt equal to 0, then this will give us N steady state, which is, all right, so what we are doing is, at steady state, this will go to 0. So, N steady state will be right. So, that is good because maybe you have information on concentration of N2. It will be easier to measure concentration of N2 because N2 is like a major species which will be expected to be present in large amount. So, the concentration is manageable, the concentration is good. The concentration of O2 will also be good. We are not very sure about concentration of O. So, this is the additional thing that I was talking about, that we can say that O2 is following this sort of, O2 and O are following between themselves, they are following this sort of an equilibrium. Okay. again, this is an assumption, we are not rigorously justifying this, but let us say that is there, and if we have that, then we will be able to write a rate expression for dNo dt. Okay, so I will just clarify what exactly I am talking about. So, we have an expression for dNo dt. This is the expression that we have. Now, that may be an object of interest for us, because we have a nitrogen oxygen system where nitric oxide is getting produced. So, that is interesting. But if I give you just this expression, it is not very convenient, because it has got N2, which is okay. It has got K1F, which is also okay. But we do not know how to handle concentration of O and concentration of N. Okay, we have a system where we have N2 and O2. So, handling N2 and handling O2 is okay, but handling this O concentration and N concentration may be difficult. If we get some expressions for concentrations of O and concentration of N from somewhere else, then we will be able to write an expression for dNo dt, which is useful, because which then tells us how to calculate the rate of production of NO. And as you know, even though you have not studied this in detail, this must be of interest to somebody, because this is like production of nitric oxide, which is a pollutant. Okay. So, we are trying to tackle this. We are trying to tackle N and we are trying to tackle O. Now, for N, we have this. So, this is convenient, but this also has O. Now, O2, for O2, we are saying that we'll assume that O2 and O are in equilibrium. And the equilibrium constant is some Kp. So, let us say this is a high temperature combustion system, and you have oxygen, which you have used from air to burn your fuel. There is high temperature because of combustion, and you have O2, we have O because of dissociation, and this O2 and O are in kind of an equilibrium. Okay. How good is this? Again, experimentally this can be checked. This works all right in many cases. Okay. So, as of now, we are not challenging that assumption. We are just trying to see that if this equilibrium is there, can we write concentration of O conveniently. So, concentration of O can be written as concentration of O2 Now, how do I get this? Any idea how we get this? From the equilibrium, chemical equilibrium calculations. So, just to make sure that I do not lose you in the process, that you everybody here understands this, just very quickly, we have this Kp, which is P of O divided by P naught squared P of O2 divided by P naught. We are talking about O2 giving you 2O. So, Kp must be partial pressure of oxygen atom squared divided by partial pressure of oxygen. That is how we wrote this. This is now Kp. So, this equilibrium constant is that partial pressure based thing. We wrote some Kc previously also, I think in the last class when we were discussing opposing reactions. And this is O, this is 0. Okay. Why it is 0? Because this is the reference pressure, which is usually 1 atmosphere. All right. So, there can be lots of confusion. This is not 20, this is O. Okay, this is 2O and this is O, this is 0. We have to remember all this. And So this makes it PO squared divided by PO2 into 1 over P naught. Remember, these are partial pressures, and this is also equal to so that is how we got concentration of O to be like this. So we used Kp, so we had partial pressures to start with, but now we have concentrations. How did that happen? How did I get concentrations? Say that again, please.
Concentration equals to P by RT.
Yeah, so we have PV equal to NR bar T, this sort of thing. So N by V, which is concentration, is P by R bar T. So we had here we had pressure, from that we have gone to concentrations, that is why this R bar T has come into picture. Okay. So check this out properly. We have R bar T squared here and R bar T square in the denominator, because this is partial pressure of oxygen squared on the numerator and oxygen partial pressure in the denominator. So I think it's okay, R bar T should be top. So this is correct. So we got the concentration of O to be like this, and coming back we have a dNO dT expression, which I wrote some time back. So this is dDT of NO. So we have this, but now we have additional information, because we have N steady state. As we had written before, it is already there in your copy, you do not have to write it again. There is K2O2 here, and we got O as O2 we have got both these here. So we can use all this information, and with a little bit of work you can show that dNO dT is So again, what I am asking you is to verify this. Nothing much to be done, I have already put everything in place, but just check that the final expression is correct. As I said, this is of interest because you have nitrogen and oxygen, and in that system nitric oxide is getting produced. So your primary interest is to see the rate at which nitric oxide is getting produced. You are not that interested in seeing what is the concentration of N atom, let us say. N atom is an intermediate. So we took care of that, we eliminated that N atom concentration by using the steady state approximation. We also had this other vexing thing which was O atom concentration. For that we say that, okay, we have seen, maybe there is experimental evidence to say that O2 and O are in equilibrium in high temperature combustion systems. Maybe it is not such a bad assumption. So we use that to get rid of O. So we have brought everything in terms of N2 concentration and O2 concentration. Okay. So that is something useful. And we will call this one, this here as a kg, and we will call it a global reaction rate constant. So dNO dT So we write this as a kg, g for global. So this is a global reaction rate constant. And we also write m and n, these are reaction orders with respect to N2 and O2. So this reaction gives you this false impression, so to speak, that N2 and O2 are reacting with each other to give you nitric oxide directly. Not the truth, but it is an overall representation. So we are not interested in the N atom concentration, let us say. We are not interested in that intermediate concentration. So we can say that the rate of production of nitric oxide is dependent on nitrogen concentration and O2 concentration to the power half. So this is a global reaction rate constant. It is hiding a few things, but it is quite useful. Now we often do this, we often do a global reaction rate constant when we are also writing expressions for hydrocarbon combustion. So again, if you have CH4 plus air, when we write all the CO2 and H2O and all that kind of business, we can write things like dCH4dT in terms of global reaction rate constant. Okay, we are not, I am not completing this now because I, in any case, I will have to invoke this later. But what I mean to say is that even here, sometimes we pretend that the methane is reacting with oxygen directly in one step global reaction. So there is a global reaction rate constant, and we play tricks like what we have played in the nitric oxide case to get expression for kg. But k global, we already have an expression for k global, we can say something about k global. So we can do something similar for more complicated situations also. So we sometimes work with global reaction rate constant. So this approach is valid, and so we, I took this example of nitric oxide formation case to tell you that first of all, steady state approximation can be used to get rid of these intermediates and give you an overall reaction rate. Overall reaction rates are useful because sometimes that is what is. That is all that you are interested in. You are interested in the rate at which nitric oxide is getting produced without bothering too much about the nitrogen atom concentration. Okay. Now, we'll, before we go to the next topic, let us think about this once more. We have discussed equilibrium, we have discussed steady state. Are these two things the same? Obviously not, because otherwise why will you have two different names? But these are good questions, because sometimes after you studied a lot, somebody might ask you a question like this and you should not get stumped.
So in equilibrium we consider also the backward reaction.
Yeah. So in equilibrium we consider the backward reaction, correct. And all concentrations do not change after equilibrium is reached, isn't it? But here there is a reactive intermediate whose concentration is kind of leveling off. It's actually even that is changing, but maybe very slowly, maybe not perceptible. Okay. The other concentrations are changing. The concentration of A is changing very slowly. We saw that dC dt is constant and C was changing at an appreciable rate. The concentration of C itself was small, but it was increasing linearly. Okay, so these two things are not the same. Do we have equilibrium if I give you a particular reactive system? You have to judge whether the forward reaction and the backward reactions are equally strong. Do we have steady state if you talk about a particular reaction set? We can judge that too. If you are looking about, let us say, the rate of the first reaction, the rate of the second reaction and things like that, and that is exactly what we have done. For this nitric oxide system, we looked at that K1, it had a very high activation temperature, so that was slow. The other reaction, the second reaction was faster. So we could say that this is probably going to give us a steady state for the nitrogen atom. Okay. So in the steady state approximation, the concentration of a reactive intermediate is assumed to level off, reach a steady state. In the equilibrium case, reactions balance one another from two directions, the forward reaction and the backward reaction. So this is not the same thing. Actually, just as an aside, when I teach heat transfer, I have asked people questions like this, that okay, so this is not combustion, but just to bring you a point that sometimes one should know the difference between equilibrium and steady state, and people are not able to answer this properly. So you have this T1 and T2. This is steady state conduction in a wall of a constant thermal conductivity, correct? And I sometimes have asked this question to students as to, is this steady state or equilibrium? And then invariably some people will say that this is equilibrium. Okay, it is not equilibrium because there is transaction, energy transaction taking place, and the temperature is not the same from one place to the other. If this was in equilibrium, you would have had a uniform temperature. Okay. Anyway, this was not combustion, but this is a good thing to remember. Now, we will go to a little more complex understanding of reactive systems. So, we discussed elementary reactions, we discussed bimolecular reactions. We now understand that reactions happen because of, in many cases, so there are other modes of reactions also, but in many cases we are interested in reactions where there are collisions, and because of collisions, reactions can take place if there is sufficient energy during the collision and if the orientation of species are proper. So, we understood that, and we know that these reactions are highly temperature dependent. There is an energy factor, we discussed that. Then we looked at zeroth order, first order, second order reactions, and then we said that okay, we are now interested in sets of reactions. So, we looked at opposing reactions, then what was the next one? Concurrent reactions, and the last one is consecutive reactions. So, consecutive reactions also gave us the steady state approximation, and we could relate to a practical example. Now, as I have been saying repeatedly, that when you have a hydrocarbon, let us say react with air, then there are hundreds of reactions which take place. Okay, so, we are slowly preparing to look at larger number of reactions. That is what we have done. One reaction, then two reactions, and then one reaction interacting with the other, like in the consecutive reaction case. We are building our skills in that fashion. Now, let us say we want to go further and look at a situation like this. All right, so this is an H2O2 system. So this has got hydrogen and oxygen, and lots of reactions take place, several. I'm giving you a sample of this. The way things happen is that if you put hydrogen and oxygen together, then depending on the temperature that you have, a reaction will produce some radicals. So, like this H or this HO2, things like that. Again, I think there's not much of a point writing this thing down because this is available in the book, plus this material I can also give you. So I think you can just concentrate on what you see on this slide here. So if you have very high temperatures, then H2 will break, giving you H plus H. What is this M? We have encountered M before. M is called a third body. So this is something which is a collision partner, in the sense that H2 comes and strikes this. It may be a nitrogen molecule, maybe an oxygen molecule, maybe something else which is present in the system, maybe argon, all right. So some kind of a collision partner. So what that M is doing is that it balances the energy in such a way that H2 can break, giving you H plus H, okay. Imagine what will happen if H2 comes and hits M and gives you H plus H, and immediately they combine, the H and H combine to give you back H2. It could have happened if M could not stabilize the process properly. So M is such that it allows H2 to break into H plus H, but it does not allow that conversion of H plus H back to H2, okay. So it is a third body, we call it a third body. It is not something specific, M is not a particular species. So at very high temperatures this can happen. At other temperatures you have H2 plus O2 giving HO2, which is also a radical, and then you can get H. So this is called chain initiation. We know that there are chain reactions. You heard that in school also, that the reactions depend on each other in a complicated way, and you start a chain and then it proceeds and it multiplies and things like that. What you have in front of you is an example of such a situation, a real life situation, hydrogen and oxygen. So the first two reactions which you just now saw, those can constitute chain initiation. If it is very high temperature, then you get the first reaction. If it is little lower temperature, then you get the second reaction. Then what you have after that is chain propagation or branching. So let us look at that. So starting from this H plus O2 giving you O plus OH, you have these four reactions, and we can think of this as chain propagation or branching reactions. All right, there is just one small thing here. I think this should be H2O, the 2 got cut somehow. So you have reactions like this. There are 4 reactions which you can see in front of you, and we can, let us cover this not to create confusion. So these are called chain propagation reaction or chain branching reaction. Which one is propagation, which one is branching? Anybody would like to guess?
Third one is propagation,
correct. What about the first one? Okay, which one is propagation, which one is branching? How do we decide that? Yeah, so I'll tell you what is the distinction between propagation and branching. We look at number of radicals as opposed to more stable species. So let us say H2O2, H2O, these are more stable species, okay. Whereas O, H, OH, these are more reactive species. So in the first one, you got one stable species on the left, okay, and one minor species, one more reactive species like H atom on the left. But on the right, you have 2. Okay, so you are getting 2 from 1, so that means it is branching. Second one, branching. Third, propagation. Fourth, branching again, okay. So the first reaction started off the chain, going out of focus, yeah, the first reaction is giving you that H which is reactive, and then that H starts playing its role. So it attacks O2, and then it immediately you got two radicals, and then they keep reacting, some propagation, some branching. So, they are building a pool of radicals. That is the job of the chain propagation and branching set. And after that, we got chain termination reactions. That's chain termination. So what does it mean? I told you what's propagation, what's branching. So you can guess what termination should be. What is termination? When the more radical stuff, the more reactive stuff get consumed to give you more stable species. So that's what is happening. If you have H plus M, then that gives you H2 plus M. So M is again not doing much, you know, it's just just absorbing the energy, releasing the energy, things like that. It's not chemically changing M. M is not a catalyst, correct? M is not a catalyst, it's just a partner in the process. So H plus H giving you H2 plus M, that means you have two active species on the left hand side, and then you are giving a more stable species, which is H2 on the right hand side. So that's when it is heading towards chain termination, correct? It is giving you a more stable species. So, O plus M giving you O2 plus M is similar. H plus O plus M giving you OH plus M is also similar, except that OH also can react. But from 2 you are going to 1. H plus O plus M, that means you have 2 more active species on the left. And you have OH plus M, so one on the right hand side. H plus OH plus M, the last one, gives you H2 plus M. This M is, may not be the same in all these, right? In fact, M is not a particular species. So H plus H plus M, in the first one you have some M, and this M that you see in the second one or the third one, the fourth one may not be the same. And H plus H plus M, happening somewhere in the gas, okay, is one M, maybe here it is happening with some other M. So it is not a fixed thing, right? Maybe here it is H plus H plus nitrogen, when nitrogen is at M, here it is H plus H plus argon, where argon is the third body, correct? So this is chain termination, and if you put everything together, then you got the complete H2O2 system. But again, we have just started discussing, so this is only one set of reactions. In fact, we just looked at the forward reactions. These all these arrows are single headed, indicating that it is going in one direction, but these can go in the other direction also. So it is more complicated than what this tells you, but that we will discuss next week. So we will close here. Thank you.